have a small group, so you know, before Evan starts, I think it might be good to go around the room and just introduce who you are, and then I'll introduce Evan. So if people can just introduce themselves, we'll start here.
I'm Peter Kautos. I'm currently a public health student at DePaul University. I'm a senior.
Oh, great. Thanks for joining us.
And our my name is Rocio Patino. I'm also a student undergraduate at DePaul University. And then, yeah, I'm going to be recording the talk.
City, And so through funding for FQHCs that are dedicated to homelessness, 75% of the people we see are homeless by the broader definition, which is HRSA's definition. It includes people who are renting by the week or month, and single occupancy, couch surfing, moving through family, unstably housed. And then, of course, people who are in encampments or sleeping in shelters, sleeping on the street, of course, we see as well. That other 25%, we can see anyone who has trouble having access to health care. So we see a fair number of undocumented people. We have a refugee health program. We have a meaningful HIV program. It's not large, but we tend to concentrate the more socially unconnected and often homeless people with HIV and have dedicated resources to them. We have a big clinic in Uptown. We have a smaller clinic not far from here, near the Haymarket Drug Treatment Center, in collaboration with them. And I'm very happy to say within 9 months or so, we're going to have a clinic on the south side. We've never had bricks and mortar on the south side. We've been going to shelters there for decades. But 55th and Halsted, 5501 Halsted in Englewood, we're very happy to be coming there and have been part of the Englewood Teamwork Englewood process and getting to know people there a little bit. We do primary care, which I think is pretty usual. We do psychiatry, which is a huge anchor for the kinds of people that we take care of. We have a very strong dental program, which is unique for poor people to have decent access to oral health care. Most of the money for that comes from Ryan White and HIV funding, but then we stretch it to reach our homeless population. So about 40% of the people we see are not HIV infected and homeless, and then we have a very robust HIV dental program. But most of what I want to talk about is our behavioral health work and some of the ways that's evolving, especially around criminal justice angles. There's two projects I'll highlight a little bit. but want to talk, you know, fairly broadly and see if I can provoke some conversation. So as Raj mentioned, I've worked with Partners in Health for now 20 years and was before medical school and really not involved clinically when Partners in Health stumbled into a drug-resistant TB epidemic in Peru. And it was in the mid-90s when Peru had a world-class TB program. Everybody was lauding the quality of the TB program in Peru. Underneath, there was this drug-resistant epidemic that was bubbling up, ignored, untreated when it was noticed. The actual policy said, we can't help those people. We'll let them die. It's not going to infect others. This is the rational way to treat a public health emergency. And Partners in Health, out of some hubris and some foolishness and certainly dedication to the people we had met, decided to treat people with MDR-TB, something that was said to be impossible at the time. And by treating about 60 patients with very difficult regimens and years of antibiotics and lots of support for side effects, we were able to cure over 85% of those people. So those 60 people became a test case for something that was deemed impossible, deemed not appropriate for policy reasons, and now has become the provocation to change drug pricing and set up infrastructure to treat MDR-TB in the rest of the world, and has really had long-term effects that my former boss, Jim Kim, who's now head of the World Bank, he would probably tell you he had planned it all out. That might be true, Jim's that kind of mind, but I think it's also just following a need, the people we met, dedication to a thing, figuring out how to do it through the community, and then proving that this policy was wrong and that the statement it's impossible to treat MDR-TB in that setting is incorrect. Partners in Health was also quite early in treatment of HIV in the poor world, and I was working in Haiti beginning in the late 90s and very substantially through the 2000s, often 6 months a year there on the ground where we got to roll and scale through HIV treatment. We had started much earlier at a time when, again, the above board policy was invest in prevention, don't worry about treatment, this generation we can't save, the drugs are too expensive, it can't be done, Africans don't have watches, you know, these kinds of statements from the public health world that were killing and damaging to people's lives. And so we were one of many groups that waded into that arena, proved that it was possible, provided good outcomes, keeping people alive. And so the question that's been on my mind, I'm about 9 months into this job with Hartman as their chief health officer, is kind of what are we missing here in our midst that everyone says is impossible or can't be done or maybe shouldn't be done? What are we missing in our midst that could be this kind of a transformative initiative? And I have some ideas I wanted to flip by you and see if we could talk about various approaches. And one of the great joys of these last number of months has been working closer and closer with Rush through the Center for Community Health Equity, through the psychiatry department, nursing department, nurse practitioners. I met this morning with the physician assistant program. We're going to have PAs come and train with us in community health. And so maybe we'll start a conversation and we'll get to continue. These are the ones that I've come up with a little bit. And you know, maybe this is the next decade. These aren't small ideas. But how nice would it be to live in a world where mental illness was not criminalized? Where the first responder to a mental health crisis was a clinician or a community member, not a policing action. What would it take to build those kinds of community supports? And how can we better support the criminal justice system in initiatives that either avoid incarceration or take into serious account mental illness that often drives people getting arrested for this and that other thing, and what kind of legal remedies may be involved, and I'll spin out on that a little bit. The other big issue that we're all facing as a nation with very uncertain direction is the problem of addiction, and especially opioid addiction, right? It's the leading killer of adults under 50 at this moment. More people die of opioid overdose than car crashes in this country. And we've really not decided how we're going to address this. The medical system has a role. Physicians and doctors have a role. Communities have the most important role in families. But there's a deep commitment to abstinence-only drug treatment that, of course, works. If someone has a problem with drugs and you're able to remove drugs completely, they do tend to get better. Some of our deepest partners, like the Haymarket Center, which is this massive, wonderful, important resource here in the city. Do people know Haymarket? It's right around the corner. I don't know how many beds they have. You may 400, 500. It's just a giant treatment center for women, pregnant women, addicts of all kinds, alcoholics, etc. Coming from social mission, coming from Catholic roots, and with a strong commitment to abstinence and the 12-step model, which of course works, and we have a clinic with them, so I'm not just throwing abstinence under the bus, but it doesn't recognize the science of addiction, it doesn't recognize the relapsing nature of the addiction, and we need to move ahead on better supports for this illness that account for the complexities of use and an approach like harm reduction. Are people familiar with harm reduction as a general principle? Thankfully, it's become much more current. And I'll talk about it in some small details with the Wolf Institute program. But in drug treatment writ large, it's still a minority point of view. And so use of medications to support people who are addicts, especially opiate addicts, to reduce use, to drastically reduce the risk of overdose, can't be done in all residential centers. Some places say if you're going to be in our place, you need to be clean of drugs. You can't be using methadone or Suboxone. And that's a barrier we can overcome. Many Suboxone programs or methadone programs, if you are taking those drugs, engaging in better care, working on all aspects of addiction, and you use on top of that, they'll drop you out, kick you out. And that consequence is not helpful to the addict who's working on a path to reducing their harm and using this. And I'll talk about some even more provocative stuff down the road. So in terms of criminalization of mental illness, being mentally ill does open up risk for incarceration, for tough encounters with the police or other law enforcement. It kills people. You know, there was another episode today I heard in the news on the way down about a woman who called for mental health help and was shot by the police who got worried when they walked into her space. And that doesn't need to be. The Chicago Police Department has crisis intervention teams, a voluntary program to train officers in engagement, de-escalation, mental illness, and ways to resolve a situation short of physical force and handcuffing and putting them in a car. It's a voluntary program. It's small. You can request a crisis intervention team anytime you call the police. But nine times out of ten, they're not available because it's too small. But that's an intervention that can save lives. I'll talk specifically about two other criminal justice programs as I move through because they're a little closer to addiction questions. There's also some really one of the real joys of this new role for me is I'm learning what community mental health supports are like when they're done by a group that's dedicated to this kind of outreach and puts investment into communities. Are people aware of this mechanism called assertive community treatment? Does that ring a bell? It was totally news to me. I did not know about it. It's a funded mechanism through the State Department of Mental Health, federal and state funding. All of that is shaky, as we all know. I'm not going to talk too much policy. But this mechanism allows for a single mental health worker, usually with a bachelor's degree or so, not a licensed therapist, to work in collaboration with a nurse practitioner, and a psychiatrist to support people with serious mental illness who are sick enough that they would be institutionalized otherwise. They carry a caseload of 1 to 10. So we have a team of 12 currently on our ACT team that support about 90 people in the community. 80%, I'm sorry, so many numbers that you're following. You have to talk kind of fast. Slow me down if I'm going too fast. 80% of their services have to be given away from the center, and they help people get to appointments, work on their medications, figure out what the doctors are trying to say, take things to the grocery, take them to the laundry, get them a haircut, you know, daily life skills. And it's the most amazing work in some ways that I've ever seen in this country. I've worked on community health stuff for a long time in other settings. But here's an example of supports for seriously mentally ill people that get lots of human contact, lots of TLC, and help to stay out of hospitals and jails and other institutions. I was shocked that I didn't know about it, and now you know more about it. It's something to be aware of. There are other layers of this funding. It's referred to by its law, the Rule 132 funding category, State Department of Mental Health. We can provide other case management services and other welcoming space for people, and that's community support individual. There are some mechanisms to help people with mental illness who get arrested on, you know, trespass or disorderly conduct kind of things, avoid jail consequences or sentencing if they do X and Y. And we just started a small pilot program to allow for people who are picked up with mental illness who are picked up for some nonviolent offense, if they come to see us a certain number of times in a certain number of months, that those charges get dropped. It's not a perfect plan, but at least it's going to drive them toward us, and we get a chance to take care of them, and then things will come over time. I'll talk about a diversion project that's happening here in the city in a minute, but first want to talk about this new project we have rolling at the Cook County Jail. So in collaboration with a group called TASC, Treatment Alternatives for Safer Communities, our group and the University of Chicago for the research overlay, we opened the physical center to receive people coming out of the Cook County Jail with mental illness, give them a place to land, a bed, a shower, a meal, connection to people, connection to services, primary care in the morning, and then they go on their way. So it's a short-term intervention, about a 24-hour intervention. It's being studied as a randomized controlled study, because that's what the U of C likes to do. The randomization is either that set of services that I explained, or randomization to provide a community health worker who gets to know them on the night they're released. We'll see them again that next morning and try to personally connect them to services, to addiction care, to anything they need. And so we'll see over time if that's a useful intervention. Very, very exciting. I think the next slide is a picture of our beautiful FEMA light trailer on the lot about 2 blocks east of the Cook County Jail. It's a very, very simple place. It's been slow to roll open. It took us a year in planning to get this far. It's a hard sell to tell someone on discharge from the jail, hey, you want to go to another place and spend another day away from whatever you used to be doing? So uptake's been a little slow. We get about 2 people per day. We have capacity to see 10. But I think it'll snowball as we take care of folks, treat them nicely, move them through, connect them to services. So it's a very exciting people may know in this room that the Cook County Jail is the largest mental health facility in the country. So we should not be shy of participants once we get rolling. Maybe I'll keep going, and then we'll have plenty of time. Plenty of time.
You know, yeah. So you were thinking about. I was just thinking in my head about your list of the two big ideas. So sort of as one of things that could change the paradigm of how we think about mental health. And I'm still stuck with this. You know, that we as providers and at the social services level and the health system level still decide to differentiate between mental health versus all other health.
Yeah.
And it's sort of, I think people did that for a long time, but they're starting to realize all these things come together, and they're looking for services that are more holistic around these issues. So there's still that need to somehow break, you know, the structural inequities we've been creating by our policies that say that all of a sudden, because you're depressed, or you're anxious, or you have schizophrenia, or you're just, you have some other condition, that all of a sudden you have to go through a separate provider, separate billing mechanism, separate connector.
Yeah. Loud and clear. The crazy title I was given when I took the job of Chief Integrated Health Officer is to recognize that even in our place with a clear mission, we don't integrate well enough between mental health and primary care. So even in our group that's not so big, it's not Rush University, and dedicated to this very clear mission, we still don't do well enough to give the capacity for primary care people to treat mental health concerns well enough and to extend their reach and support them in doing that. And then there's also some silos that I think were still in the history of this time.
Yeah. There are two other things I was thinking. One was around, mental health, depending on where you are in the social gradient, gets treated differently in your status.
Yeah.
So if you're in River Forest and you have depression, or you're an artist and have depression, you get a different persona and respect than somebody who's homeless and has depression.
Which is, again, I know I'm forcing a bit of a conversation, but I think because of that, there are very specific vulnerabilities for the mentally ill in criminal justice. So a poor person who doesn't think, who has disorganized thoughts, gets picked up for bad behavior and gets arrested. If I was walking around Evanston disorganized, that might be treated differently. So and I'm personally quite interested in criminal justice issues and legal issues, not legal issues, but I take your point that it's not an entirely separate category, although I do think there's some very specific vulnerabilities for mentally ill people around incarceration and the tangles of the justice system.
And the final thing, as I've been reading the JAMA and other things, thinking about mental health, I don't know why we as the United States feel so proud that we cannot accept evidence-based programs that are done at a fraction of the cost in other countries, right? So even in JAMA, they just, with two articles, one in Uganda, one in India, showing that if you can get uneducated individuals, less than a high school education, to provide some basic training around mental health services, almost like your ACT program, that they actually do a better job than sending them to a physician to provide those services. But we just don't want to accept that, right? That we can actually do this at a very low cost and actually get to a lot more people by not worrying about the drug, but actually thinking about the people connections.
Or about community health workers providing that are fully educated, they're maybe fifth, sixth standard, sixth grade education in India, and they're, trained them due to CBT, cognitive behavioral therapy, and postpartum depression mothers.
No, there are tremendous models. Yeah.
So beyond the college educated, we'll really bring it into the community.
Yeah, we have some miles to go there.
I also think the discomfort of many PCPs around mental health issues does not help this issue. It's not. I know that many PCPs sort of struggle with having to, write prescriptions for medication. They're not having a full psychiatry, training to give these really pretty heavy medications. And so I think the discomfort and the split in the medical field. integrated if the psychiatrist didn't leave and then everybody else, I think it would be different because other parts of medicine are not pushed off in the same way that psych is.
And I rushed through the introduction because I wanted to have this conversation, but the thing that I think most makes Heartland's not the answer, we're just part of working on this stuff, but the thing that makes Heartland unique is the behavioral health supports. So we have outreach workers who are in the street every day, reaching people that are hard to find, trying to pull them into care. We have this layer of like ACT team and others who are not clinicians, but then also licensed social workers, addiction counselors. We have these layers of support that are not medical. They're behavioral health, they're run by a psychologist, they're in collaboration with primary care and psychiatry, but I think that can be the glue in a programmatic way, because they get close enough. It's not community health work in this kind of robust, bottom-heavy way, but it does get us closer to really knowing, you know, what people are struggling with. Is it, you know, is it details of the housing, or is it something else? You know, I think that anchor is underdone in this. Medicine is top, and it's driven by prescription and providers and power structures. So I think there are ways to diffuse that. Not that it answers all my questions. Please.
I agree from one perspective, because even if you do have mental health, there's some parallels going on at the same time. And the people in the community have an ability to actually see what's going on as opposed to people coming from the outside looking in.
Yeah.
And in that way, they can provide much more support system. Even if you treat someone, it's what happens afterwards is really makes just as much difference as the treatment.
Yeah. You know, dealing with community level needs and say the issue of violence and trauma at a city, I mean, that could have been or should have been the whole thing today. That's a much bigger ball of wax that can't be solved by medical system. That's going to have to come from the communities. I chose to focus on these because they're parts of work in progress, but I agree with you 100% that even with these tools well applied, we're not getting to understanding nor addressing some of the root causes: poverty, disruptive families, violence, other needs. You know, that's real. Let me keep going and add addiction to the mix because I want to talk about that. And you know, I think increasingly there's understanding that it's a mental illness. And can be dealt with in those ways. One very exciting thing, just wanted to highlight because it's happening and it needs to expand. The Chicago Police Department came to Heartland and University of Chicago and Threshold, which is a community mental health group, about a year and a half ago, and asked, can we help send people who are picked up on drug charges to treatment rather than jail? This was the police idea. And as a longtime activist, it makes me natively uncomfortable to go into the police station or to sit down with the West Side Narcotics Drug Force team or the lieutenants from the CPD because I have my own, you know, feelings and perspective, but they've been incredible partners to this process. In the course of their action to look at disrupting the drug distribution networks, they know people who are selling. And so on designated days, they'll go after these folks who are facing felony distribution charges and give them an opportunity to go to drug treatment rather than to arrest. I learned just a couple weeks ago that arrest is even booked under the name John or Jane Doe. So there's not even, they need to keep track of the process of arresting someone, but if you pull it up in a criminal record search, it doesn't appear. If people choose to go to treatment, there are no charges, they don't go to drug court, they don't have to do X or Y or Z. They're simply given the chance to engage with treatment with us. So I put this language of deflection because it's actually a deflection project. We're deflecting people out of the system rather than diverting them to a drug court that says if you can prove you're clean for 90 days and we test your urine and we put you in that kind of police state, then you're free. This is a pure deflection. The CPD wants it to expand citywide. They want it to be precinct level. They want it to be ongoing. And we have no means to take in that many people who need our services. So there's a thing that we can work on. there's issues with this problem. Not everybody who's selling is a user, so addiction treatment may not be the thing that person needs if they're selling to make money or selling opiates to use to feed some other addiction. You know, it's not a perfect match. So far, it's a one-time deal. I think there's a group in Seattle that's doing this more on a population level, so people who are part of this program, when they do slip up and get caught up in the criminal justice system again, they're given a second and a third chance. And so we're going to work toward a more robust harm reduction approach to this, but it's happening. And we don't have enough place in the city to take these people in and take care of them. So this is an issue. And I wanted to put one very concrete idea. I think an important service that a small university like Rush could provide is to allow or facilitate people coming into the emergency room wanting to get off opiates, to engage them, start them on medications. It's called induction. You kind of start with especially Suboxone. It works very quickly. A couple days of doses, you block their cravings, you protect them from accidental overdose, and then could roll them up into services. We're never going to be able to have our doors open 24 hours a day, but there are facilities on this campus that have that. And so a collaboration between an emergency room that could take in someone on the front end of addiction need, help them get started, and then robustly connect them through thresholds is approaching this with sign up. And I think their idea is essentially this. It's not my idea. Thresholds has a good drug treatment center on the west side, and they're working with the emergency room to place one of their staff there to engage people who are coming in, asking for help, get them started on medications, and then connect them to ongoing services. It's often those first couple days where you lose somebody. They come in and ask for help, they start to withdraw, they feel horrendous, and then the cycle starts up again. So that's a thing we could think about. Just a few other highlights of what we're doing, and then one last really, I think, exciting and dramatic potential. Needle exchange works. It's hard to do because you need to be part of some research protocol. It's heavily restricted, but we're starting to do it. There's a group called the Chicago Recovery Alliance in Chicago. If you're ever interested in this stuff, they're a wonderful resource. They'll give you as much naloxone as you need for overdose prevention. They'll give you clean needles to help you get connected to drug treatment. They're a wonderful resource, a nonprofit. People use in our facilities, so bathrooms can be made safer by providing doors that open outward so that if someone collapses inside, you don't block the door, giving them cleaner, more sterile spaces, sharps disposal boxes. Like there's some small things as institutions we can do. I glanced on this before, but there's a huge need, again, with the abstinence-only dogma. Most residential places, halfway houses or residential treatment centers, are not very accommodating to people who are using methadone or Suboxone. So if you say you went to rehab, did great, got stabilized on methadone, and you needed someplace to go, it's hard to find a halfway house that would support that. There's no single reason that's purely dogma. That's not medical or psychological. Same for Suboxone, et cetera. So that's a need. We're working on organizing users to help motivate from the people who are most affected. And then I want to land by talking about supported injection or safer consumption spaces. Are people familiar with this idea at all? A little bit. So in Europe, especially Portugal and the Netherlands are very advanced in this. These are photos, I just pulled them off the internet, I've never been there. This is a place in Vancouver, British Columbia, where drug users, the epidemic of opiate use and heroin use was highly concentrated in the neighborhood on the west, I think the west side of Vancouver. The users got together and said, look, we need to be protected from infection, we need to be protected from overdose, we need help in managing our addiction. Can we have a place to do that? So this is called the Insight Center. You walk in, they give you what you need to inject. You bring your own drugs, and it's not a heroin prescription program. Those do exist in the world. I don't think we'll get there anytime terribly soon. And maybe it's not needed, but you walk in, they give you what you need to inject safely. They put you in this well-lit, sterile place. You use your drugs. If you overdose, someone's there to reverse and catch you. If you need help assessing for infection or abscess, someone's there to look at you and get you to care. And it's proven at this site and all the others in Europe that folks are twice as likely to get off drugs if they use a facility like this. Twice as likely. So not only are you protecting from overdose, you're protecting from infection, you're helping people preserve their veins, you're helping them get to treatment. And it's something I think we can do in this city. It's a couple of years, it'll be a couple of years in the works. But there's enough interest and the science behind this is quite robust. And so I think this is a direction we will head. And it's, of course, going to mean lots of risk taking and coming along for the ride. But the users are talking about it. us as advocates talking about it. And increasingly, city public health is also considering this. Yeah.
Do you know if these centers are testing drugs as well? Because I know Seattle had a very preliminary one of these centers set up,
yep.
and they were testing the drugs as well.
Yep. I'm not sure for insect, but I would expect they do. So the concern is adulteration, well, certain potency, even if it's just heroin, how much is there? And then adulteration with these higher grade, very dangerous drugs like carfentanil and fentanyl. So yes, I think so. There are some pretty rapid ways to do that. And that's also a service. If somebody brings you the drugs and say, no, these are good, I got them from my guy, I've known my guy forever, and you can show them that it's crud, that's an incentive to maybe think twice. And if all these are ways of engaging and pulling people back from the most active driving harm. I didn't talk much about overdose prevention, but it's it works. You just need access to some training and to naloxone, especially for opioid overdose. CBD doesn't carry naloxone at this point. Neither does the sheriff's department. They have 6,000 officers. And we're working on that. I think we're going to get that done within the next 6 months. Some collaboration, but every officer should have overdose, the reverse potential. In our residences, you just put it on the wall, put it on the cabinet, no questions. It's there to be used. We have a few reversals every year. So that's it. Those are the things I wanted to talk about, and I hope I didn't talk too fast. But again, just thinking of ways, there's such deepening collaboration between Rush and Heartland, especially around addiction issues, and there's some work that needs to be made better there. And I think more broadly on consideration of mental illness and entanglements with the criminal justice system, I wanted to highlight the supported release center and that space. And of course this deflection project, which I think has great potential. The police want us to make it citywide. I'm speaking out of school a little bit, but I think if we told them we could do it across the city tomorrow, 24 hours a day, they would be happy to. That's a lot less people tangled up in the jail for sometimes not terribly important charges. Yeah. Ideas? That's it. That's plenty.
Has there been a study of the amount of money it costs jailing versus this program? and then bring it to the city?
No. And sadly, I don't know that word, but it has to be less expensive. It's very expensive to jail. I'm running through the system. For our program, it's too small. Uh-huh. It's been a pilot. We've touched about 150 people. And we're looking at criminal justice outcomes as well as addiction outcomes. So one of the other potentials is perhaps you receive somebody, offer them help. Are they less likely to reoffend? Are they more likely to stay out? And so that cost savings can also be considered.
Right.
So it's ongoing. But I would bet a dollar it's saving in a few ways. Yeah.
I know you said you didn't want to talk about policy too much.
That's fine.
But, I mean, just thinking about, because, things like this, there's so much science behind it, saying that it works.
Yeah.
But as a society, we have to be very much, addiction is being, a moral issue and things like that. And, I'm from southern Indiana, where, there was the HIV outbreak a few years ago, and the writing was on the wall before that really happened. But even then, there were some needle exchange programs on an emergency basis.
Yeah.
But still that was so, even when you see that those things work, it still is so unpopular in society.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
How do we even, I don't even know if there is an answer, but how do we start getting things out there in a way that people see it for the science rather than seeing it for blaming people?
Yeah.
Right.
And respecting, I didn't go into it much, but this isn't an answer. I would love thoughts from the crowd. But most medical addiction programs, treating with methadone or Suboxone, if you test positive for heroin or cocaine or something, they just kick you out. You're just done. And how's that helping? Of course, what we do, and we're not alone in this, is if someone's in our program, they're seeing us, they're doing well, we start to see them every 2 weeks instead of every 1 week, and they test positive for opiates or heroin in your system. We'll say, hey, we want to see you back in 3 days, see how you're doing. We engage them, have to pull them back in, but keep them close until they stabilize. So it's a relapse in the disease. And I think, again, sciences or public impressions of science are catching up to that to some small degree. But thoughts on how to fix that? No, the moral overlay is heavy. I mean, we're struggling with it now. I mean, in national policy, Trump's a mess on every possible level, but around opiate stuff, it's, you know, there, in fact. Those are not scientific or public health discussions, they're moral discussions. And we can collectively remove that. And I think at least recognition, I don't know how much money, but there's a thing called the Addiction Network, if you've seen their commercial. They must have gazillions of dollars because it's on MSNBC like all the time. But the only thing that's in that commercial is this weird looking young disheveled doctor says, addiction is a disease. I think that's an important message. I think it's a stupid commercial. But I think that's an important message. And we're turning the corner on that rather than it's a moral failing, it's a bad choice, it's something else. It's an illness that can be treated and we know how to treat it. But talk too much. Yeah.
I think there's also this issue too, I kind of touched upon it a little bit and I think some other people have as well, of perception. But there's degrees and levels of perception of, again, homelessness, but also who is an addict and who is a safe addict and who is someone who someone perceives as being a violent addict. And so, I mean, when you talk about intervention with police, that brings in a whole other caveat of trust or lack thereof for various other vulnerable populations that are out there that have these other mitigating factors that are affecting whether or not they are users, whether or not they have some other, you know, propensity to be engaged in other types of
or prior charges or association or all,
all of that. Mm-hmm. And so I think it's great to have these interventions, but I think there's that other aspect too of those vulnerable populations of utilizing community persons that already have built relationships with that demographic and beginning to have these types of conversations with those entities because they can be bridge builders as far as the trust factor goes.
Yeah.
Because again, let's be clear, a lot of people don't trust the Chicago Police Department for various different reasons.
Nor should they.
Right?
Yeah. I'm excited that this work is proceeding. I told you about my own discomfort, which is meaningless because I'm privileged. It is not an answer. It's not a public health opinion. It's a good thing, you know, for these people who don't get charged, arrested, put in jail, put on bond, put through whatever cost that. But it is not an answer. You know, from this, again, I'm just kind of dreaming big because I got a chance to speak and this is what we work on. But I think the answer would be, you know, when someone's having a mental health crisis, addiction or otherwise, someone from their own community should be the first person who, you know, 911 or whatever should connect to someone from their neighborhood and looks like them, who knows their experience, who can speak with them in ways that authority could never, and let care proceed from that. But as it is, if someone's acting up and someone gets worried, 911 would police show up and police do what they, you know, you go to the bar, you're going to get a haircut. That would be a foundational problem. The policing is modest. And their cynical reason is because they want a good story, right? They want good publicity for this great thing they're doing. It does nothing for the 99% of heart that they're doing.
And I'm trying to remember, there is an organization that's actually working on the South Side with training clergy to be like a call center for trauma and addiction, I think. And I have to pull up the email.
Yeah,
try and find that.
We'll be in touch. Yeah.
There is someone who is actually doing, trying to do that type of work of bringing in clergy.
Yeah.
I think
specifically dealing with trauma.
No,
whatever.
I mean, is it like that, where they have a really strong understanding of their own communities, but also strong understanding of the problems associated?
So the train is going through the University of Chicago. And so I'm not sure if that's a replication of this model that's already out there, but when I talked to them, their definition of trauma was anything that someone said that there was a traumatic incident. They were not being very specific about it. They're trying to have a very broad umbrella to wrap people into their network.
Yeah. Tremendous. No, I think like community health or like community mental health, diffusing it out away from centers into people's homes with human level support. You know, we're doing that through this professionalized mechanism like a sort of community treatment. But there's no reason that can't be made larger. Yeah. No, it'd be lovely to
I'll look that up.
Yeah, we'll be in touch.
And I think one of the difficulties is also some of the ethics around the providers and this mechanism, especially around substance abuse treatment. So, you know, there was a piece on NPR that was about 2 weeks ago, and I was caught in traffic, of course, going around on the expressway. But it was an interesting piece about why Orlando has become the largest place in the country for addiction treatments, right? So they started because they were providing services for the rich and wealthy in Florida. And eventually they decided, because the way the laws were written, that they could set up these residences where people would come in for treatment. They would get funding from the state to provide those services while people were in treatment. And those same providers or somebody next to them was building the drug house right across the street.
Yeah.
So their entire goal was to, you know, get money for people staying in the treatment part, moving them over where they would be tempted next door with the drug, and then getting them re-addicted, overdosing, having the police called, naloxone given, and essentially ending up back in their own situation.
Yeah.
So how do you prove, you know, we have to be ethical with our own systems around protecting people instead of taking advantage of individuals that are at their hardest needs, you know, and it's in. And I think it's always been in the mental health world, and I don't blame the mental health field, but this is a long-standing view sometimes of what mental health is about. You know, you start with the institutionalization, or even if you watch Beauty and the Beast, have you ever noticed that, about that one little piece of where you know, they try to institutionalize her father?
No.
All right, so it stays, right? It stays in our culture, in our psyche about, you know, mental health and people taking advantage of you and using the most weak. How do we keep preventing our systems from getting more and more ethical and providing services and weeding out the people that are not doing the right services?
Well, I'm clear. I mean, it's not by accident that the jail is the largest mental health facility in this country. You know, we're concentrating people in that institution rather than the curators. I'm being very sincere and precise about this induction to Suboxone in emergency rooms because I think that can break that cycle. So to save some safety net hospitals, pulling somebody in, admitting them, getting them upstairs, treating them for 4 days on methadone, and then discharging, that's money generation. That's filling beds, and that's doing business. It has no role in helping the second addiction. It has no role medically. But you know, what's it going to take to let them collaborate with us so that we can take those patients and try to care for them in a more longitudinal and serious way? That's cutting into business where it could be a little tricky. I've not heard the story about Florida, but I'll look it up. It sounds sounds very possible. Yeah.
Could you speak a little bit more about the safer consumption spaces?
Sure.
You said that people who access them are 2 times more likely to be able to go on to recovery. What's the psychology behind that? It's so antithetical
that
we're usually given about the same wrap up.
I don't know because I've never done it, but I imagine it's like needle exchange. You know, if you're giving somebody clean needles, you're taking care of them. You're giving them advice on skincare. You're asking them, hey, do you want to come in and see a primary care doc? Do you want to think about slowing down on use? It's a point of engagement. So I think it's human contact. It's straight talk about what they're doing, making a choice to do something to reduce harm, and then further engagement. So I think it's human. I don't think it's any medical type intervention. Similar with the needle exchange program, we're gonna give out crack pipes with our needle exchange. Now that doesn't make any sense because these are maybe opiate users who want the needles, but it's a human kindness, and they don't have to go improvise their own pipe, and we're being nice to them, and maybe they'll come back. And on the 27th time, maybe they'll ask for more help. So I think it's that.
Do you know in the recent studies that you sent in, do they use that kind of language? Do they talk about human kindness when they talk about?
I know we do in our shop, you know, and I know that harm reduction people do say, I care about you. You know, your body's hurting. Do you think you can slow down? What can I do to help you slow down? You're using 8 times a week. Can we talk about 4 or 5? You know, so I hope so, and I think so. And again, the physician. clinician types are probably less likely, and the behavioral health people maybe more. Yeah.
Well, having worked with traumatized people, but having read up a lot, I really think it's having something, a formal structure of a human being helping me to be safer.
Predictable, trusted.
When, you know, whether you're chasing a high or escaping withdrawal or in whatever is happening in your life that may be fueling the addiction, in that, you know, the loneliness, the hopelessness, and that, you know, wow, there is actually a formal system of someone helping, you know, and I can imagine the hope when you have an ounce of strength that helping, you know, when you don't know that there's anything, aware of anything, when you have that ounce of hope, how easy it is to slide back when you know that that's been there.
You keep coming, you keep engaging, you keep going out, you meet them where they are. Yeah, I think that's for sure.
Hey, and we've talked here about how do we get the hospitals more engaged in this, and there is interest internally here. And Roger Carney, sort of the thought, one of the thought leaders of it, about Suboxone in the ED.
Yeah.
And then with referral to an expanded program that we might do here, but also to community health centers. And then really thinking about how do we get the other institutions also to do this. Because, you know, we have to take on the suffering and actually figure out, great, whatever supportive systems we can to do this. So I do think that there's certainly growing interest here. And when, you know, we talk about the group of institutions that are, I would say, pulled together on the west side around business practices, buying locally and purchasing locally anchored institutions, there is, you know, discussion about how to move this to what could we be doing together around healthcare delivery, HIV, HCV, substance use and addiction.
Yep.
You know, are three things that just sort of pop to the top of the list of things that we could do together. So there may be some opportunities that arise, and other folks in the county who are very interested, you know, but honestly interested in pulling together. But I do think that there's an opportunity to really think about this more broadly and begin to sort of...
Lovely. I can update you a little more on the police deflection project that's letting people go to treatment rather than jail, and that needs to expand. Your old hospital, Mount Sinai, is talking with Thresholds to use the emergency room as intake for their addiction care. So embedding a Thresholds person in their emergency room, receive people who are asking for help, get them started, and then connect to the Thresholds. That model could work, and we talked about it before.
Yeah, we've heard, like, you know, Esperanza, I know Access, you guys.
Yep.
So I think it's...
Lawndale's doing more. Lawndale Crystal is doing,
you know,
Suboxone.
Taking those energy, then getting the hospital, where a lot of people are coming in.
Good. Hey.
And then maybe even moving further outside the clinical space. So I don't know what that looks like exactly, but...
Mental health is, like the Healthy Chicago 2.0, it's like, you know, mental health issues are
everywhere. And so we talked about that at almost every forum, and people had things that would never occur to me. Mm-hmm. And then in terms of resources, they said, you know, they're like, oh, we can put the clinics down for mental health, and they were like, and put, like, talk to your neighbor, or talk, you know, like, they were like, that's a resource to us, that is, like, talking to your family, your neighbor, in a way that we don't think of clinically. So I think kind of taking your presentation on the road and asking people in the communities what their ideas are would come up with something that would never occur to us.
Yeah, I would love to catch up on what you've collected. And we're doing it as well as we can in Englewood through the Residents Association, through Teamwork Englewood, through talking to partners there. But probably not enough. You know, the more we can listen and be a part of that, the better we'll be. Yeah.
And I think it's going to have to be that way. Maybe
very good examples, I think in the city for long term on Swedish has been working for many years with sort of a stabilization center set up about 200 feet away from their emergency room, so if somebody comes in a crisis, they can recognize it. They don't even bill or process somebody through the ER and force those extra charges. They get them over to the stabilization center, where it's a lot more cost effective and a lot environmentally friendly for everybody. They've been the model we've had in the city for a long time with the Catholic churches. But the other thing is, there was a lot of fanfare about a year ago, and it was an idea I liked. I was thinking about it on the West Side for the same sort of, stabilization center idea. So the city, CDPH came up with a lot of fanfare about opening one on the South Side, where police can, instead of bringing somebody to Churchill, we'll bring it to Roseland and place there.
What's open?
But what Julie Morita's been talking about is people aren't going.
Right.
Right. So you build it, they don't come. Right. So then you have to really think about what did you do, right? You just spent $1 million on building a center, and nobody's coming. And then how do you fix that? So I think tying it in with the community needs is where you have to solve it, because that's where it's going to be. It's not going to be at a site that's separate from where people are engaging or interacting.
I think one of the biggest problems is the community doesn't know. Yeah, I mean, even the community I work in, I'm doing volunteer work, but like 10 more people, there's a 63rd hospital. And you guys need to study in West End. Now, people ask people all around, rather study First National, nobody knows what's going on. So part of it is actually that people are aware of what's going on and actually giving them the ability to have empowerment over there. They don't know which control they actually have. Lives. You know, people live in a 6-block radius their whole life, so they don't really know what's going on. So, I think that's the biggest thing is how can the people get to understand how they can actually make their lives better through the resources that are coming into the community.
No, it's true that it's such a big city, and like you said, there are neighborhoods where blocks are all that matter. West Englewood is not Englewood, or not North Englewood. I don't know how we're doing on time. I think we may be close.
Yeah, well, thank you. I think we're right at the hour. I appreciate everybody's comment and feedback.
Thank you. Yeah, this was helpful to me. Thank you.
Keep in mind, you'll be presenting at the Health Disparity Social Justice Conference in the fall this year, so another chance to meet out. All right, thanks again.
Thank you.